Good morning, everyone. Am I on? Can you hear me? Yes. Good morning and welcome to United Unitarian Universalist Congregation. Here at United, we honor the many faiths and spiritual beliefs within our congregation and our world, nurturing our sense of community and togetherness. My name is Jennifer Beiriger, and I am the worship facilitator for today's service. Our music today is provided by our very own music director, Alex Chislin. Chislin, that's a new way to pronounce your name. Child care is available just down the hall. A reminder to all that face masks are now optional, and as hopefully a step forward, we are reintroducing the use of our hymnals. Yay! We extend a special welcome to our visitors and guests, and especially to our special guest speaker today, Dr. Carl Siegfried. Dr. Siegfried is on the Theology and Religious History faculty at Cherry Hill Seminary and is adjunct professor in humanities at Illinois Institute of Technology. He serves as Gothi priest of Thor's Oak Kindred, a diverse organization dedicated to the practice of the Ásatrú religion in Chicago. He holds degrees in religion, literature, and music, and he is the first Ásatrú practitioner to hold a graduate degree from the University of Chicago Divinity School. During his time at the university, he was president of Interfaith Dialogue and Life Council. Dr. Siegfried, I'm mispronouncing pretty much everything today, will briefly join us in our coffee hour after the service. Please join us downstairs in our fellowship hall. Welcome, Dr. Siegfried, and thank you for leading us in today's worship. Just a few announcements. Alan Poplosky and Jeff Blankenmeyer have very joyous news. They are welcoming their third grandchild, Darcy Fay, born on July 27th. Darcy joins siblings Owen and Greta. Congratulations to all. The first annual Community Multicultural Fair, sponsored by SOFIA, will be held at Cutler Park on August 13th from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. United will have a table set up at the fair. Be sure to come by and or help out. Please talk with Ellen for more information. And don't forget the Alex Chislin concert night here at United on August 3rd. All are invited. If you've not purchased a ticket, they will be available at the door for a price of $5 each. This is a musical night you really don't want to miss. And now, please center yourself for worship as Dr. Siegfried leads us with his opening words.
Good morning. I'd like to begin by thanking Jennifer, Sam, Patricia, Aaron, and everyone else who's worked so diligently to put this morning together, and it does really mean a lot to me to be invited and welcomed here. The song that we heard in the background as gathering music takes its text from the Old Norse pagan poem Völuspá, Prophecy of the Seeress. Translated into modern English, these are the opening words. Hearing, I ask from all the tribes, greater and lesser, the offspring of Heimdall. Father of the slain, you wished me well to declare living beings' ancient stories, those I remember from farthest back. Heimdall, whose name means world tree, is the Norse god considered to be the father of the classes of humanity. So the audience for the poem, the song, and this gathering of ours today is now made up not only of all the tribes of humanity, but of all the social classes within those tribes. The god Odin makes the request for the prophecy as father of the slain, as a god who oversees death and the dead. And he wishes the unnamed prophetess to recite the past tales of all living beings back to the very beginning of mythological time. Here, at the opening of the core cosmographical work of what survives from ancient Norse polytheism, the audience is all-encompassing as the speaker embraces the diversity of the entire human family. For ancient pagans of Northern Europe, hospitality was arguably the highest value, and welcoming the newcomer was a core social duty. In today's Norse religion, we continue to embrace this value and duty as we celebrate diversity and welcome all people of positive intent to join us, learn with us, grow with us, and celebrate with us. Today's service will focus on our connections to each other, to those near and distant in place and time. I'll be sharing some thoughts on the weaving of the human tapestry from an Ásatrú perspective. Ásatrú is the name we use for our religion. It's a modern Icelandic term meaning Æsir faith, referring to belief in or faithfulness to the major tribe of Norse deities. Practitioners often self-identify as heathens without any negative connotation, and the term heathenry is generally used to refer to the wider range of contemporary religions that seek to revive, reconstruct, and reimagine various North European polytheistic traditions dating back to approximately 2000 BCE. The past history of Northern paganism stretches from the Bronze Age through the Viking Age, a long period in which local variants developed among the Germanic peoples of continental Europe, the Nordic countries, and the British Isles. Although large-scale practice ended with the coming of Christianity, private worship is documented for several subsequent centuries. Some beliefs and rituals survived into the 20th century as elements of folk religion throughout the Northern European diaspora. Since the birth of the modern religion with the founding of Iceland's Ásatrúarfélagið, the Æsir Faith Fellowship, in 1972, modern practice has spread worldwide through a mixture of national organizations, regional gatherings, local worship groups, and lone practitioners. The Ásatrúarfélagið has been recognized by the Icelandic government since 1973, and Ásatrú is now Iceland's largest non-Christian religion. In the U.S., the Department of Defense officially recognized Ásatrú and heathenry in 2017, thereby granting full religious rights to practitioners in all service branches. Although there are clergy today known by the Old Norse term Gothar, singular Gothi, there is no central Ásatrú authority and no set dogma. Throughout today's heathen world, there's a great variety of beliefs and practices, spanning a range from humanism to reconstructionism, from viewing the gods as metaphorical constructs to approaching them as distinct beings. Deities venerated in Ásatrú include Odin, Thor, and Freya, but respect is paid to a large number of figures. Ásatrú is a world-accepting religion. Emphasis is placed on right action in this life rather than on expectation of otherworldly afterlives. Practitioners assert that we are our deeds, meaning that the sum of one's actions is of primary importance. For grounding and inspiration, followers of Ásatrú turn to a diverse set of texts that includes Greek, Roman, and Arabic descriptions of ancient Germanic peoples, myths preserved by the medieval Icelander Snorri Sturluson and his Danish contemporary Saxo Grammaticus, Old Norse, Old English, and Middle High German mythic and heroic poetry, legendary and historical sagas of Iceland, and later folklore collections. Many practitioners also study and write modern scholarly work in disciplines such as archaeology, history, medieval studies, and religious studies. Thor's Oak Kindred, the Chicago organization that I lead as Gothi, is named for the tree sacred to Thor, the god who protects and blesses the communities of gods and humans. Many of us wear pendants of his lightning hammer Mjolnir to mark our adherence to Ásatrú and to show our dedication to the positive values for which Thor stands. The most famous Thor's Oak once stood in what is now Germany and was venerated by a great multitude of pagans. We hope that something of its spirit inhabits the tree around which we hold our own celebrations, and I hope that today's service will provide you with a positive example of our Ásatrú perspective.
Each Sunday, we light our flaming chalice, a symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith. Please join me in saying the words found on the back of your handout. May this flame kindle within us the warmth of compassion, the flow of love,
This is a story called Linda Gold and the Old King, written by Anna Wallenberg, who was born in Stockholm, Sweden in 1858 and lived till 1933. She was an author, poet, and playwright who wrote short stories and novels, ranging from fairy tales about elves and trolls and enchanted forests to deep reflections on educational opportunities and financial independence for women in modern society. To the younger people in the audience, as you listen to the story, I'd ask you to ask yourselves what it means. Myths and fairy tales often tell a straightforward surface story with characters and plot while suggesting a deeper meaning of moods and morals. Why does the old king act like he does? Why does Linda Gold act like she does? What has changed in the heart of the king by the end of the story? What does any of this have to do with our own lives today? It may mean something very different for you and your parents, and it may mean something different again for them and for your grandparents. Here is the story. Long, long ago, there lived an old king who was rather eccentric. People said he was odd because he had many sorrows. His queen and children had died, and he himself said his heart had been torn apart. Who had done that and how? Someone with claws, he said, and since then he imagined that everyone had claws on their hands. No one was allowed to come nearer than 2 arms' lengths to the king. His valets were not allowed to touch him, and his dining room steward had to place his food at the very edge of the table. The king had not shaken anyone's hand for many, many years. If people were careless enough not to remember about the 2 arms' lengths and came an inch closer, the king had them clapped in irons for a week to refresh their memory. In all other ways, the old king was a good king. He governed his subjects well and justly. Everyone was devoted to him, and the only thing his people regretted was that he had not found a new queen or chosen an heir to inherit the realm. When they asked him about this, however, he always said, "Show me someone who does not have claws, and I will make that person my heir." But no one ever appeared who, in the king's mind, did not have claws. The claws might be under the fingernails or curled in the palm, but they were always there, he believed. Now, one day it happened that the old king was walking alone in the forest. He grew tired and sat down to rest on the moss and listen to the birds singing in the trees. Suddenly, a small girl rushed up the path, her hair streaming behind her. The king heard a growl behind him, and when he looked around, he saw in the trees a shaggy gray beast with flashing eyes and a grinning red mouth. It was a wolf who wanted the little girl for breakfast. The old king rose and drew his sword, and straightaway the wolf turned in fear and ran back into the forest. When the wolf had gone, the little girl began to weep and tremble. "You must walk home with me now," she said, "or else the wolf will chase me again." "Must I?" asked the king, who was not accustomed to taking orders. "Yes, and my mother will give you a loaf of white bread for your trouble. My name is Linda Gold, and my father's the miller on the other side of the forest." The king realized she was right. He couldn't very well let her be killed by the wolf, so he decided to accompany her. "You go first," he said. "I will follow behind you." But the little girl did not dare walk first. "May I hold your hand?" she asked, and moved closer to him. The king started and looked closely at the little hand raised to his. "No, I am sure you have claws too, though you are so small." Linda Gold's eyes filled with tears, and she hid her hands behind her back. "My father says that I have claws too, but I've only forgotten to cut my nails." She looked ashamed and cast her eyes down at the ground, but then she asked if she might at least take hold of his mantle, and the king agreed to that. He simply could not make himself tell her to keep 2 arms' lengths away, for she was only a small child who would not understand. So Linda Gold skipped along beside the king and told him of her cottage and all her toys. She had so many beautiful things she wanted to show him: a cow made of pine cones with matchsticks for legs, a boat made from an old wooden shoe with burdock leaves for sail, and best of all, a doll a mother had sewn for her from an old brown apron and stuffed with yarn, and had a skirt made from the sleeve of a red sweater and a blue ribbon at the neck, and her big brother had drawn a face on it with coal and put a patch of leather for a nose. The old king listened patiently to all her chattering and smiled. He was sure her little hand had claws, yet he let it pull and jerk at his mantle as much as it wished. When Linda Gold and the king came to the highway close to the mill, the king said goodbye. Now Linda Gold could go the rest of the way home by herself. But she did not want to say goodbye so soon. She clung to his arm and tugged it and begged him to come with her. How could he not want white bread, which was so good? It couldn't be true that he did not want to look at her fine toys. She would let him play with her doll all the evening, if only he would come home with her. She would give him a present, the boat with the burdock leaf sails, because he had saved her from the wolf. When none of this helped, she at last asked the king where he lived. "In the castle," he said. "And what is your name?" "Old Man Greybeard." "Good, then I will come to visit you, Old Man Greybeard." And she took off her little blue checked scarf and stood waving it as long as the king could see her. And he turned to look back quite often because he thought her the sweetest little girl he'd met in a long time. Even after he returned to the castle, he still thought of her, wondering if she really would come to visit him. He was worried because she did not want to keep her little hands at a respectful distance, but he could not deny that he longed to see her. The next morning, the king felt sure that Linda Gold would not dare venture out so far for fear of the wolf, but then he clearly heard a child's voice calling from the palace yard. He went to the balcony and saw Linda Gold with a rag doll under her arm. She was arguing with the gatekeeper. She said she must speak to Old Man Graybeard about something very important. The gatekeeper just laughed at her and replied that no Old Man Graybeard lived there. Then Linda Gold got angry. He mustn't say that, she insisted, for she herself knew very well Old Man Graybeard did live there. He had told her so himself. Next, she went up to a lady-in-waiting who had just come outside and asked her advice. No, the lady-in-waiting had never heard of Old Man Graybeard either, and she too laughed heartily. But Linda Gold did not give up. She asked the cook, she asked the steward of the household, she asked all the courtiers who had begun to gather in the courtyard to stare at her. She turned red in the face as they all laughed, and her lower lip began to tremble. Her eyes were full of tears, but she still maintained firmly in a clear voice, Old Man Graybeard must live here because he told me so himself. The king called from his balcony, Yes, here I am, Linda Gold. She looked up, gave a shout of joy, and jumped up and down in excitement. Do you see? Do you see? She called in triumph. I told you he was here. The courtiers could do nothing but stare in surprise. The king had to command twice that Linda Gold be brought to him before anyone obeyed. It was no less a person than the royal court's master of ceremonies who led her to the king's chamber. When the door opened, Linda Gold ran straight to the king and set her rag doll upon his knee. I will give you this instead of the boat, she said, because I thought that since you saved me from the wolf, you should have the best thing of all. The rag doll was the ugliest, most clumsy little bundle imaginable, but the old king smiled as if he were quite delighted by it. Isn't she sweet? Asked Linda Gold. Yes, very. Kiss her then. And so the king kissed the doll. Since you like her, shouldn't you thank me? Demanded Linda Gold. Thank you, said the king, nodding in a friendly way. That wasn't right, said Linda Gold. Not right? How should it be then? When you say thank you, you must also pat my cheek, she said. So the king had to pat her on the cheek, but it was a warm, soft little cheek and not at all unpleasant to pat. And now, said Linda Gold, is there something more? Asked the king. Yes, I would like to pat your cheek too. Here the king hesitated. This was really too much for him. Because you see, Linda Gold went on, I cut my fingernails. She held up both her small, chubby hands for the king to see. He had to look at them whether he liked it or not. And truly, he could not see anything unusual on the pink fingertips. The nails were cut as close as a pair of scissors could, and there was not a trace of a claw. You can't say I have claws now, Graybeard, said Linda Gold. No. Well, pat my cheek then. Linda Gold patted the old sunken cheeks, and soon a couple of tears came rolling down the old king's face. It was so long since he'd known affection. Now he took Linda Gold in his arms and carried her to the balcony. Here you see the one you have always longed for, he called to those in the courtyard. A loud cry of joy broke out among them. Hooray for our little princess! Hooray! Hooray! They shouted. Surprised and bewildered, Linda Gold turned to the king and asked him what they meant. It means they like you because you have fine small hands and have no claws and never scratch, he said. Then he kissed the two little hands so that everyone could see, and from below the people shouted again, Hooray for our little princess! And that is how Linda Gold became a princess, and when the time came, inherited the kingdom of the old king.
One way in which we build our sense of community is by sharing the milestones in our individual lives, those joys and sorrows that make up who we are. If you have something to share, please come forward to the microphone, tell us your name and what you wish to share. Take a stone from one bowl and place it in the bowl that has the water. In this way, your joy or sorrow
We just heard a story about connections between generations. This connection is a focus of Ásatrú religious practice as we take time in each of our gatherings to honor our ancestors. We define the word ancestors to simply mean those who are no longer with us. Nowhere in the Norse myths and poems are the gods' human subjects addressed, defined, or portrayed as limited to any specific identity or defined location in the modern senses of those words. In Thor's Oak Kindred, we follow this conception and reject any form of discrimination and exclusion on the basis of race, sex, orientation, identity, origin, ancestry, age, or ability. As in our opening song addressing all the tribes, we open our hearts to celebrate the feeling of interconnectedness with all humanity, past and present, the sense that we are all connected to the complicated saga of human experience. For today's meditation, I would ask you to briefly do as we do and think of a person no longer with us who has had a meaningful impact on your life. This can be anyone from a departed family member to an inspirational activist, from a personal friend to a beloved author. The music for meditation is Baldur's Mini, in memory of Baldur, a celebration of the bright and beautiful god murdered through the machinations of the malicious Loki. Please meditate on someone now gone who has brought or continues to bring brightness and beauty to your own life. Okay, if we could fade out the music, please. That was our opening song again, but it's a good one too. For our reading, I would like to read a selection of verses from Havamal. These are the words of Odin, who is a god of wisdom and wandering, poetry and power, creativity and consciousness, language and learning. They come from the Old Norse poem Havamal, Sayings of the High One, which presents Odin's teaching in the form of short aphorisms. I've selected lines and verses relating today's theme of connectedness. If Odin sometimes seems like Old Man Greybeard in today's fairy tale, it's because Odin was long ago known as the Old Man and as Greybeard, and he is the model for Gandalf, Dumbledore, and all the wise old wizards we still read about. Here are some things he has to say. Blessed be the givers. A guest has come in. Where is he going to sit? Fire is needful for someone who's come in and who's chilled to the knee. Food and clothing are necessary for the one who's journeyed over the mountains. Water is needful for someone who comes to a meal, a towel and a warm welcome, a friendly disposition, if he could get it, speech and silence in return. Only that one who wanders widely and has journeyed a great deal knows what sort of mind each man controls, one who's sharp in his wits. It's a great detour to a bad friend's house, even though he lives on the route, but to a good friend's house, the way lies straight, even though he lives far off. Mutual givers and receivers are friends for longest if the friendship keeps going well. You know, if you have a friend whom you really trust and from whom you want nothing but good, you should mix your soul with his and exchange gifts. Go and see him often. I was young once, I traveled alone, then I found myself going astray. Rich, I thought myself, when I met someone else, for man is the joy of man. The fir tree withers that stands on stony ground. Neither bark nor needles protect it. So it is with the one whom no one loves. How should he live for long? One need not give only a big gift. Often you buy praise with a little. With half a loaf and a tilted cup, I've got myself a companion. One brand takes fire from another until it is consumed, a flame kindled by flame. One becomes clever by talking with another, but foolish through being reserved. No one is completely wretched, even if he has bad luck. One is blessed with children, another with kinsmen. Another has enough money, another feels good from his deeds. It is better to live than not to be alive. It's the living one who catches the cow. I saw fire blaze up for the wealthy man, and he was dead outside the door. Cattle die, kinsmen die. The self must also die. I know one thing which never dies, the reputation of each dead man. The mind alone knows what lies near the heart. He is alone with his spirit. No sickness is worse for the sensible one than to find no contentment in anything. I advise you, apprentice, to take this advice. It will be useful if you learn it, do you good if you have it. You know if you have a friend, one whom you trust well, go to see him often, for brushwood grows and tall grass on the road which no one treads. With your friend, never be the first to tear fine friendship asunder. Sorrow eats the heart if you don't have someone to whom to tell all your thoughts. Never hold up to scorn or mockery a guest or a wanderer. Don't bark at your guests or drive them from your gate. Be kind to those in need. Mighty is the lock that is lifted to grant entrance to all.
Each week in our church, we take up an offering. We pass the plate during worship to make a community expression of thanks for the blessings of abundance. Our offering says that the act of giving is an essential part of our spiritual well-being. The morning offering will now be received.
The Norse mythology that forms such an important part of the conceptual background for Ásatrú religion provides a triple concept of time that undergirds our modern practice and shapes our understanding of our relational place in the world. The Old Norse poem Völuspá, Prophecy of the Seeress, which we heard a bit from at today's service, tells of three mystical maidens who come from the water beneath the world tree. From there come girls knowing a great deal, three from the lake standing under the tree. Urthr, one is called, Verthandi, another. They carved on a wooden slip, Skuld, the third. They laid down laws, they chose lives for the sons of men, the fates of men. Paraphrasing these lines, the medieval Icelander Snorri Sturluson writes, "These maidens shape men's lives. We call them Norns." Associated with both water and trees, sources of earthly life in the myths, they have individual names derived from Old Norse verbs related to the act of becoming. Urthr and Verthandi are both connected to the verb vertha, to become, and so can be interpreted as what has become and what is becoming. Skuld parallels the verb skulu, shall or must, and taken with the other two can be read as what must become. It would be an oversimplification to translate them as past, present, and future, since their connection to time is paired with senses of both emerging action and necessary cause. These associations are echoed in modern practice as we speak over the ritual drinking horn in our services, and in a modern Ásatrú worldview as we consider our deep connections to others. Intrinsically related to the mythological portrayal of the Norns is the idea of Wyrd, W-Y-R-D, a concept at the theological heart of Ásatrú. It stands behind, runs through, and supports our words and deeds. It connects each individual's present moment to her past actions and to the actions of those around her. It forms a constantly shifting matrix that connects us all as we move through our intersecting lives. The word Wyrd comes from the Old English language. To Anglo-Saxons, who practiced a form of Germanic paganism when they first came to what is now England, the meanings of Wyrd included what happens, what is done, a deed, an action, fate, fortune, chance. The farther we go back in the history of a language, the greater the range of meanings embedded in each word. This is what makes it so difficult, for example, to clearly translate ancient poetry. The parallel Old Norse term for Wyrd is Urthr, which generally means fate. The same word is used in the myths for the Norn, whose names can be translated as what has become. As she sits at the well under the root of the world tree and joins the other Norns in shaping men's lives, why would the one associated with the past be the one whose name means fate? Part of the answer can be found in the meanings of the modern English word descended from the Old English Wyrd. Wyrd, W-E-I-R-D, in the sense it was used by Shakespeare, means the principal power or agency by which events are predetermined, that which is destined or fated to happen to a particular person, what one will do or suffer. Taking the Old English, Old Norse, and Modern English together, there's a curious combination of action and fate. These two concepts seem quite different on the surface level, as those of us raised in a modern Western worldview tend to make a distinction between, one, the actions we take of our own free will, and two, the futures that are fated to occur by some deity or supernatural force. For practitioners of Ásatrú who believe that we are our deeds, the two ideas are inextricably linked. What actions you have taken in the past determine what fate awaits you in the future. This is not mystical predetermination at the whim of an omnipotent deity, but rather a system of cause and effect determined by actions here in the world. It's also not an ideology of rugged individualism in which each romantic hero single-handedly determines his own destiny in a triumph of the will for two important reasons. First, although your actions add color, weight, and strength to the thread of your life, that thread continues to tie you back to your beginnings at birth. Second, as you move through time, your thread is woven together with those of many others to form the tapestry of Wyrd. Together, these two basic concepts underscore the connectedness at the heart of an Ásatrú worldview. Before you're born into consciousness, the deeds of your parents determine the first anchor point of your life's thread. In the United States, we embrace the myth of the American dream and pretend that every individual has an equal chance of success in worldly things. The concept of Wyrd tells us something else entirely, and I believe it is more honest about realities in this nation. The actions of your parents shaped your Wyrd long before you were born, as the actions of your parents' parents shaped theirs. A child born to a crack-addicted and HIV-positive mother in a poverty-stricken neighborhood has a much different Wyrd than does one born to a high-level bank executive or real estate developer with a deep portfolio of profitable investments. No matter how hard the first child struggles to take control of her own destiny, she will have to trudge a long and difficult uphill road filled with obstacles before she reaches even the starting point of the second. Much of what we tell ourselves about level playing fields and the benefits of a traditional work ethic is designed to obscure this basic truth of the functioning of Wyrd. We seek to deny that past actions have future consequences and embrace fictions of forgiveness that forward the idea that our past deeds can be erased from existence and their effects eliminated. Whatever we want the world to be, whatever we will ourselves to be, the past continues to exert its influence on the present. It is this power that is expressed in the idea that Wyrd represents the principal power or agency by which events are predetermined. This predetermination is not predestination. As you live your life and make constant large and small decisions about what actions to take, those actions slip into the past and affect your present. The thread of your Wyrd does not snap and separate from what has been spun in the past, but with enough effort on your part, it can take twists and turns that change its orientation in the tapestry. The weaving of the tapestry occurs when the deeds of others intertwine with your own. Your Wyrd crosses that of everyone with whom you come into contact, family and friends, classmates and colleagues. Your deeds affect their Wyrd and theirs affect yours. The more contact you have, the more actions you have taken together, the more closely intertwined your threads in the fabric become. This is not necessarily a matter of choice. If a student in your class who's never spoken to you has been abused by a family member to the point where he snaps, brings a rifle to class, and puts a bullet in your brain, his Wyrd has profoundly affected yours, regardless of your own will and desire. Truthfully, his abuser's Wyrd has affected yours, and the Wyrd of those who drove the abuser to abuse have affected yours. At any moment in time, webs of Wyrd spread out from that moment into countless strands tied to past deeds. The farther you gaze from this moment into the past, the greater the number of individuals have influenced the present reality. Taking this thought to its logical conclusion, it's clear that we are all connected. Every day your Wyrd is affected by people you will never meet. An IRS agent in Washington flags your tax returns for auditing because your name reminds him of a college admissions officer who treated him unfairly when he applied for financial aid. A FedEx driver loses the CV you overnighted for a job you really need because she didn't sleep the night before due to her fight with her father over end-of-life care. A factory owner in China produces a plastic bowl that leaks toxins into your child's oatmeal because the local governor pressures him to ignore safety rules in order to remain competitive in the American market. In each case, you are deeply affected by an action that is taken by someone with whom you have no personal contact, and their acts are connected to the actions of others still behind them. We cannot pretend that our free will is the sole determiner of our individual fate. We're all connected by the workings of Wyrd, even if we staunchly deny its power. Yet you are not the passive recipient of the Wyrd of others. You are not the victim of powers beyond your control. As the deeds of those around you affect your Wyrd, your own actions affect theirs. The closer your relation to a person, the more impact you have on her life. Your deeds also spiral out from you, intersecting and interweaving with the actions of others, affecting innumerable individuals whom you will never meet face to face. For practitioners of Ásatrú, it is action that is paramount. What we do is more important than what we say. Earlier this morning, I read the words of Odin, in which the wise god said, "I know one thing which never dies, the reputation of each dead man." The preceding verse in the poem offers the same lines with a slightly different conclusion, in which the deity says, "The glory of reputation never dies for the man who can get himself a good one." The old English Christian poem known as The Wanderer, written down around the year 975, includes a strikingly similar verse. Its first half is nearly identical to the Old Norse pagan poem, stating that possessions and wealth, family and friends, and even the self itself all have finite existence. The second half of the Old English poem, however, deviates sharply from the Old Norse. Rather than remarking that reputation never dies, the Old English poem states that all this foundation of the earth will become worthless. That's quite a difference. The Old English Christian poem responds to the realization of the transitory nature of life by denigrating the worth of the world itself and suggesting that the afterlife is all that truly matters, a perspective made explicit in further verses of that poem. The Old Norse pagan poem replies to the same situation of realization with an insistence that deeds in the world are what truly matter, that the only immortality is in the reputation we leave behind, in the mark that our actions have made upon the world, for good or ill. The Old English poem forwards a world-denying spirituality. The Old Norse poem offers a world-affirming way of living. What difference does this make in our daily lives? I believe that theology is only worthwhile when its tenets make an appreciable difference to our actions. When theologies focus obsessively on afterlife assumptions rather than this life engagement, what beneficial difference do they make in the lives we live? Taking another step down this theological path, I would challenge the worth of theologies that reinforce harmful prejudices rather than challenge us to find new ways of seeing, that buttress an inequitable status quo rather than tear down the walls of inequality, that encourage us to passively accept the world as it is rather than stimulate us to take positive action for beneficial change. The gods, goddesses, and land spirits of Ásatrú are both in and of the world. The old academic notion of nature religion may still have some value, as we who practice this tradition naturally connect with an attitude of affirming the world and our own place within it. We embrace a theology that is intrinsically connected to positive action in the here and now and serves modern lives that are deep, mobile, and vital. An ongoing goal in our practice is to connect the mythological and the divine to the public lives we lead. We embrace the core idea that we are our deeds, that it is by our actions in the world that we are known and judged by our peers and by posterity. with the important injunction that ritual speech and ritual action and religious celebration mean little if they do not change how we act in the world. We as a religious community assert the inseparability of the spiritual and the material and insist that the world-affirming religion must affirm the world. In our religious celebrations, we pass the drinking horn around the oak tree and each speak in turn. We address gods, goddesses, land spirits, the earth herself, and ancestors in the expansive sense I spoke of earlier. I've already mentioned that the Norn of past actions shares her name with the concept of fated future happenings. In parallel with this mythological and linguistic concept, our celebration of ancestors turns to the past to chart a way for the future. In our ritual rounds addressing ancestors, members of our group have hailed deceased family members with whom they have personal connections, family relations, larger ancestral groups, aspirational ancestors, and those who are kindred by choice, such as close family friends. In addition to addressing such individuals and groups from across a wide racial and ethnic spectrum, participants have hailed as ancestors a diverse range of figures who are not directly related to the speakers. These include African American victims of police brutality, Asian Americans killed in hate crimes, Syrian refugees who perished while seeking freedom, LGBTQ+ activists who founded social movements, casualties of HIV/AIDS and COVID-19, journalists who stood up to powerful political forces, and early environmental activists. In each instance, the speaker expressed a strong sense of connection to the deceased person or people, often evoking similar feelings in the other participants. Given the diversity of the individuals and the openness of the ancestral concept, the turn to ancestors crosses all constructed lines of race, ethnicity, and class as it moves far beyond a narrow idea of blood relationships as determinant of connection. Several years ago, an African American member of our group hailed Thor Hall the Huntsman, a member of Eric the Red's crew who sailed to North America around the year 1000. A resolute pagan in the age of Nordic Christian conversion, Thorhall is said by the Icelandic saga authors to, quote, have paid scant heed to the faith of Christianity since it had come to Greenland. Thorhall was not popular with most people. As a black man practicing Ásatrú in a mostly white and mostly Christian region of southeast Wisconsin, our kindred member felt a deep kinship with the stubborn pagan who clashed with Eric's Christian crew. For this modern practitioner, an engagement with the ancient texts embraced by today's Ásatrú led to a personal connection with an individual distant in time and place that was subsequently celebrated in the multicultural and intergenerational setting of the group celebration. The expansiveness of this view of ancestry nurtures the ability of participants to deeply empathize with ethnically and spatially other people as it reinforces the webs of connection between all that have been, are, and will be. By bridging the mythic and historical with the factual and contemporary in our celebrations, we egg each other on to perform right actions in our personal, professional, public, and political lives. To egg someone on is a modern English phrase from the Old Norse verb eggja, which means to urge someone to perform an action. The German philosopher Immanuel Kant writes of an oft-repeated ceremony by a religious community under laws of equality that through the formality of a common partaking at the same table, for us passing the drinking horn around the tree, in fact, quote, contains within itself something great, expanding the narrow, selfish, and unsociable cast of mind among men, especially in matters of religion, toward the idea of a cosmopolitan moral community. And it is a good means of enlivening a community to the moral disposition of brotherly love, which it represents, end quote. The idea that the group ritual both expands the outlook of the individual and builds a diverse moral community is, in my mind, connected to the American philosopher William James calling attention to the perhaps obvious but often bracketed fact that men's thinking is organically connected with his conduct. Taken together, they suggest a theological approach to celebration as a community that drives, as an agent that drives individual action. This approach to connecting the mythical and ritual realm to the everyday world permeates the structured yet open form of our rites. In the speaking round of the specific deity or deity group that opens each celebration, participants thank the gods for what has happened in the usually recent past and ask for positive continuance, improvement, and inspiration in the usually near future. By addressing the gods and goddesses in this way, we focus our attention on the good of the past and focus on positive action in the future. Our speech within a ritual that straightforwardly connects the mythology to our daily lives pushes us each to act in a progressive and engaged manner outside of the ritual. And we assert that it is a positive act to fully situate our modern practice in our diverse modern world. To paraphrase James, theology, like philosophy, is only to be taken seriously insofar as its propositions make an appreciable difference to us in action. Our theology determines the form of the rite that leads to diverse individual experience within the rite that leads to positive action in the world. Reinforced by the emphasis on wide-ranging relationships in our celebrations, the Wyrd concept builds an awareness of interconnectivity between far-off actors. An acknowledgement, for example, that our consumer choice to burn fossil fuels without restraint has profound consequences for families in areas already experiencing traumatic effects of climate change. A conception of the global workings of the web of Wyrd through both our personal stories and our multitudinous impacts upon the world reflects Odin Own's emphasis that it's through our deeds that we are known and remembered, even as we build an understanding of the interrelatedness of all human actors. We are still weighing the ramifications of the Supreme Court's announcing a decision that severely hampers the ability of the Environmental Protection Agency to regulate climate-changing carbon emissions. The Ásatrú ideal of weighing the wider implications of one's deeds and considering the consequences even for those we will never meet seems very needful today. Despite the romantic impulse to see ourselves as sovereign individuals and the nationalist impulse to divide ourselves into separate tribes, we're all connected. Together, our individual threads make up one great human tapestry, and each of us has a responsibility to always strive for right action. If we are willing to embrace it, Wyrd will weave us together. Well, I couldn't have made better lyrics to go with what I've been talking about today than that hymn. I'd like to again thank those of you who invited me and worked to make the service possible, and I'd like to thank all of you for being open to hearing from an unfamiliar faith and for allowing me to spend this time this morning introducing some of our core concepts of theology and practice. So what is today's take-home message? What is the call to action? The message is that we're all children of the world tree and we're all connected to each other. When I say all, I mean all. We insist on dividing ourselves into discrete tribes and separating ourselves into belligerent camps, but our actions have effects far beyond the barriers that we build between each other. We so often see that categorizing as us and them inevitably leads to living as us versus them. We too often see how hateful political rhetoric and harmful online harassment lead to tangible harm in the physical world. If we think with the web of Wyrd concept, we can see how the threads of our lives connect over, under, around, and through the barriers between us. We can begin to reconsider the reach of our actions and the results of our deeds. And this is the call to action, to realize that the connections are already there, whether we will or no, and to ride that realization into new ways of weighing the consequences of our actions and new ways of deciding what deeds are worthy of doing. It can be as difficult for us to accept the connections we have with others as it was for old man Greybeard, the king who fearfully imagined that every hand held a claw. It sometimes seems like we are a nation full of fearful people who imagine the worst of those we view as other. I believe that we are our deeds. I believe that our actions in this world matter more than our allegiances and identities. Whether or not you agree, it can be a meaningful exercise to meditate upon the web of Wyrd, your place within it, and the reverberations that your deeds send through it. Hopefully that meditation will lead to more engagement with action and consequence. I'll conclude as we do in Thor's Oak Kindred with the final words in the Old Norse poem Hávamál, Sayings of the High One. Now are the High One's words spoken in the High One's hall, very necessary for sons of men, unnecessary for sons of giants. Luck to those who spoke, luck to those who know. Use them, those who learned, luck to those who listened.
And now we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. Please carry in our hearts these principles until we are together again.
So I just realized that I forgot to switch my microphone on when I got here, so sorry about that, Aaron. In the order of service today, it says a song by Fleetwood Mac, but I decided on one that felt a little more in line with today's message. This is a song by Van Morrison. We were born for the wind, also younger than the sun. Yeah, the bonnie boat was won as we sailed into the mystic. Hark now, hear the sailors cry. Smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and your spirit fly as we sail into the mystic, yeah. When that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. When that foghorn blows, I want to hear it. I don't have to fear it, and I want to rock your gypsy soul. Just like way back in the days of old. And together we will float as we sail into the mystic. Ba ba da 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 da. Ba ba da 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 da. Ooh. I gotta hear it. As we sailed into the mystic.